Hello, guys and girls, and welcome to episode 35 of the VR Inside podcast. This is a weekly VR, AR, and MR talk show that is live streamed every Saturday on Nathie's YouTube channel. You can tune into the show live now at the new times of 7 p.m. in Europe, 6 p.m. in the UK, and 12 a.m. in Central US. If you miss the live stream, you can catch up with the whole show every Sunday, where I re-upload the show to my own YouTube channel, Virtual Reality Oasis. Or check out the audio-only version, which is available on Google Play Music, iTunes, and on SoundCloud. If you enjoy the audio version of the show, please leave a review. That would really help us out. If you've got any comments, questions, or feedback during the show, please put them in the chat. We'll try to answer as many questions as we can. So if you're new to the show and you've never met us before, let me introduce you to the team. First up, this guy has been suiting up this week, but not in his Tesla suit this week. No, no, no. He's been suiting up in a suit of armor to go jousting in VR. It is Nathie, of course. How you doing, man? You all right?
Yeah, I love taking risks, especially if I need to beat Rowdy, you know? So, yeah, we had a great time jousting against each other. I know. So, yeah, it was fun. But I will talk more about that later.
Okay, of course. So next up, this guy loves nothing more than to cut the toenails of giants. It is, of course, our resident pedicurist, the Rowdy Guy. How you doing, man? You all right?
I knew you were going to take that one. I knew I shouldn't have played that one. I played so many titles and you knew you were going to take that one, but no, it is fine. It is fine. Yeah. It was a good time. I'll talk some more about that one later as well.
Okay. So we all know that if it doesn't work out on YouTube or, you know, your career as a scientist or whatever, that you can cut toenails and be a pedicurist.
Actually, I think that's a much more profitable option.
You're probably right. Okay, next up, our resident VR Twitch streamer is reporting live from the field, live from VRLA in Los Angeles. It is our resident Twitch streamer, Zimtok5. How you doing, man? How you doing? You all right?
Good, Mike. It's been an aggressive couple of days, you know?
I bet it has.
Literally with 36 hours notice, someone's like, hey, you want to come to California? Like, yeah, why not? Let's do it. It's like, we're going to put you in against Phil Hellmuth in a poker game. It's like, okay, sounds pretty good. So yeah, I'm in California now.
I love that we can do this from all over the world, you know, like remotely. So if one of us does go on a crazy VR adventure, then we can just remotely sign in and talk about it live. It's so, so cool. Thanks for being on the show, dude. And you just need to say now, back to the studio.
Back to the studio, Mike.
Thank you. So last but by no means least, myself, the bearded bald guy, Mike from Virtual Reality Oasis. In today's episode, we've got a jam-packed show for you. We're going to be talking about the Oculus Go hands-on impressions. Is this the best mobile VR headset available right now? Well, we'll be sure to tell you. We're going to be talking about Beat Saber, slicing cubes and smashing records, why this VR rhythm game is doing so well. And also, we're going to get the live scoops fresh from Zim from VRLA. Our reporter in the world gives us the fresh scoops from the floor. So let's start this show up with what we've been playing this week. And let's start it off with Nathie. I'm intrigued to know what you've been up to in the metaverse this week, mate.
Yes. Well, I played Jousting Time and I had to face Rowdy. And it went okay-ish, okay? So. Yeah. It's a cartoony game. We have been talking about this in, I think, two episodes ago. And it's a cartoony jousting game where you, first of all, need to do a round of rock, paper, scissors to
It's basically psychology that you need to use to find out who does rock, paper, scissors the best.
Okay, wow.
Wasn't me. But yeah, after the you did that round of rock, paper, scissor, and the person who wins will be able to pick a weapon first. So Rowdy. So the people who like lose in that first round are usually the ones that don't win in the end. No, because you get the sucky weapons, okay?
Oh, is there like OP ones, the ones that you need to get?
There's just one that wasn't my favorite. Was like the maze, right? And yeah. I couldn't do it. It was too hard. And
for some odd reason, I still managed to hit you with that one like one time, and
yeah,
it was over.
Yeah, one time, and then I died. But so the first round is all about, you know, winning that rock, paper, scissors thing. That's like the most important like part of the whole game, as far as I know. But then you face against each other. And in one hand, you have like a melee weapon. And in the other hand, you just need to move your horse. So you just go like that. Yeah, like that. And then your horse starts to move a bit. Then you go to like the starting line, and then you see your opponent on the other side. You can just wave to them. It's very, very cute. It's a cute game. It's not very gory or, well, maybe a little bit. I mean, you can lose your head. But in the end, it's still a cartoony kind of game. So yeah. Then you need to scream as hard as you can and just pick up as much speed as you can to then destroy your opponent. So Rowdy was just screaming at me, and I was screaming at him. And then it happens so fast where you might have hit someone or not at all. And then you just look behind you, you're like, hey, I think Rowdy hit me or not. And like there's a narrator telling you if you hit someone or not. And you also get some info. But right. The coolest thing about this game, and I think Rowdy can talk a little bit more about that, yeah. is the how you see it on the screen for other right. people out there. Right,
right. right. Because yeah. also, like, from what I saw in your videos that you uploaded was when you were screaming, I was just thinking, oh, God, your neighbors must be thinking you're getting murdered or something in your house.
Yeah.
Like, did you have any, like, complaints from your neighbors about noise or anything?
No, but my brother said, like, yeah, I think you had a good time. So, like, yeah, I had to destroy Rowdy. I mean, that's awesome. So in the end, it's a fun game. Sadly, their Kickstarter we have been talking about didn't make it. They're still going to bring it out to Steam and maybe home or other platforms, but they are not going to do everything they said in their Kickstarter. So they will tone their development time down to a more, you know. So we'll see. But it's still coming out. I'm happy it's gonna come out. And mobile users can also play this game together with people that do have a VR headset. You can sit in the audience with your mobile phone and then right. Send like love to Rowdy, for example, or me, and really yeah. cheer yeah. Your they, favorite person.
They really had some awesome concepts in that. Like, you know, the like Nathie said, like the that you can join with a mobile phone and like cheer for your favorite kind of jouster. That was a really cool, neat concept. But indeed, like the part of like the different cameras, since they have like for every scene there's a different camera that is being placed, makes it very, very interesting for a content creator like all of us to be making content for this, because it's so cool that you, it's basically like a little movie that is like playing off, like, you know, you and you yeah. can see yourself acting.
Yeah, it's very interactive. Yeah.
Yeah, and the best part is if you put like a camera of yourself up there, he's like mimicking like the movements of the little guy that is like doing all the jousting stuff. So it's really hilarious to see yeah. that. Yeah.
Yeah. It was really great watching the videos back. And like you say, it makes them look way more cinematic than if it was just from your first yeah. person view. And I think that's a real thing that developers should start thinking about more, is how their game looks when content creators and people that promote their games on YouTube or Twitch, how that's going to be portrayed. And certainly, like, I think that's part of the success of why Beat Saber did so well, was because they had this like viral marketing campaign where they showed this amazing view using the Live technology, and it just made it look so fun and great to play. And if they start sort of integrating that into more games, or like their own yeah. tools, like their trebuchet right. is with this jousting game, then you yeah. can really make your game look really interesting and exciting from a different perspective. But so it's great to hear, though, that I didn't realize actually that the Kickstarter campaign had failed, but it's great to hear that they're still going to make the game. And it's still great that they're going to have people that can join on their mobile phone and cheer to the jousters and watch their favorite streamers live. You know, that's yeah. a really cool feature. Because, yeah, if you didn't know, that the game is actually developed by Trebuchet, which is the same studio that did Prison Boss, right?
Yeah, correct.
Right.
Zim?
I had a quick question for you there, yeah, sure. Just in terms of the way you connect, it sounds almost a lot like this, what you call it, a pancake game, Jackbox, which comes out of the, you know, You Don't Know Jack series, I think. And mm-hmm. and you get a code, and that's how you kind of join and you're able. So those who are cheering along in this game, how do they actually connect with the game?
Yeah, it's actually, it's a link that they can follow, to which I think, well, I mean, we didn't manage to try that one out because the Kickstarter already failed as well before we actually got to like promote the video. But yeah. The thing is, there was a link that was displaying in the top box, and if people follow that link, they'll go to like a viewing scene, which I think is like two things that they can do is that you have a mobile headset and you look in the crowd like that, or that you're actually seeing the actual image that is being displayed on our screens as well, like with the moving cameras for every scene. I think that is what they're using for, like, the just general pancake gamers.
Just to connect. Cool. Thanks.
Cool. So apart from like cutting giant's toenails, or is that what you've been up to this week, Rowdy? I'm intrigued.
I've played a couple of things. I've dove back into Pavlov. I've played a lot of Pavlov lately. Yeah, I've really been enjoying that one. I want to try to like get a little bit more like competitive gaming on with there. Not that I want to go into competitions, but I want to become like a little bit better in those kind of games. So I've been playing with those kind of things. And then, of course, yeah, cutting giant's toes. I've been doing that. I've played some more Beat Saber, like the logical games, I guess. And then, I played some Wands. I played like I didn't really play any new titles, really. Like more like titles that I've played before. I also played Edge of Nowhere. Per Nathie's recommendation.
That's a cool one. Yeah, that is a cool game.
I started that one. But I don't know yet if I'll bring it out on the channel, but I've been playing those kind of titles.
So with Pavlov, have you been playing with that ProTube that you've got, or have you just been playing normally?
Yeah, I started with playing with the ProTube, but for some reason, maybe it's my weird anatomy or something, I feel still more comfortable without a ProTube. Like I can aim better. And I think it's because when I try to aim with a ProTube, maybe I don't have it like set completely right. But I always do like this when I bump with my headset against the stock, so I can't really get the aim right. And by the time that I get my aim right, I'm already dead. And then I spawn again. I do the same thing. I run to an enemy, see him. Damn, I can't, and then I'm dead again. So I'm still more comfortable without the ProTube than I. Yeah. But that's probably my lack of skill more than anything else.
I do think using those, because I've tried one myself. I 3D printed one and tried it, and I have to say it takes a skill to learn how to use it effectively. I think so. You have to adapt your playstyle to use it, but I think once you do have that adaptive playstyle, you probably do have a slight edge over the competition. Maybe more in Onward than Pavlov, because Pavlov's quicker.
Definitely, because with Pavlov, what you get like is you need to recharge, reload really quickly, like, because you can just infinitely reload. With Onward, there's only a few magazines, I guess, that you can put in there. But with Pavlov, you can just like take them and like put them back in, and you can do that really fast if you don't have like something where your controls are stuck in, because you can. I've seen Viper play this, and he can literally do it like plug it out, take it, and then plug it back in, and he's really fast with that. But I don't have that skill at all.
Yeah, but like Viper's like on a different level. Like he is down after all.
He lives
like, So
it's his home. You know, he doesn't have a real life anymore. I just go back to the substation. Stage. You know,
that's if you cut Viper, then pixels will just come out. what about you, Zim? What have you been playing this week?
Well, one thing I wanted to say that we touched on the show floor, which is kind of a parallel from what Rowdy just said. Do you remember we were talking about the 3D rudder, which is like a...
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
We've got the train going on. Which is like a... It's like a pad that you put your feet on.
Yeah.
And if you can imagine, like, the Oculus Touch analog stick, if that was large enough to put 2 feet on, that's essentially what it does. So you can kind of go left, right, forward, back. And so I was playing air car in that. But like one of the applications that I thought was really interesting is for players who are playing Onward or Pavlov, etc., who want to just sit down after a couple of hours. They're like, but they still want to keep playing?
Yeah.
They can use this instead. And I can actually see how that's accessible. I didn't even know this thing was in the stores yet. But it is out. It's been out here for a year for like $100. So that was interesting to actually try it, having talked about it on the show.
Did you like it?
Would I buy it personally? Probably not. If I had any issues in terms of mobility issues, missing an arm or something, then I would definitely do it. Or if I was uncomfortable standing, so someone with like back or knee problems, I think it's like I was able to fly through, if you guys know the air car demo, where you're flying to this futuristic city, very Blade Runner-esque, just with ease. Like, it was easy to kind of navigate, and I would just hop in. So there wasn't much of a learning curve. And the fact that you can just buy it here in the U.S., there's a big electronics store called Fry's. You can buy it in those shops, like, off the shelf. It's really easy for consumers to get it. So, like, having heard the use cases for the thing, I can see where there's a market. And I think it can give an advantage. There's some advantages with that controller, which can help people in kind of special situations. And it's not just necessarily like medical or physiotherapy. It's people who just want to sit down. For instance, I want to play a game that requires me to stand. In fact, that I'm going to sit down and I'm going to play it this way. So that was one thing, just because it paralleled and was a nice segue from what Roddy was saying.
So Zim, before we move on, can you talk a little closer into the in your phone?
Oh, sure. Yeah. So so the other thing I was going to say was in terms of games I played this week, the main one to mention, the reason why I'm here in California, is Poker VR. So I know we're going to touch a little bit on the Oculus Go later, and I'll give some impressions. But having played that game for the last 2 years, there was a predecessor, actually, title called Casino VR Poker. They rebranded recently. They launched on the Gear. They've launched with the Go. And I've played a Rift build now, and that's what we're showing here, which is kind of a new sneak peek of what it's going to be like. So playing that is really, really cool. They've actually itemized in a way that I remember recommending to the team that they not do, because, like, you know, we all know the TF2, Team Fortress 2 hats escapade, where it's like, oh, I can pay for or unlock extra hats, and, like, who feckin' wants to look like Santa Claus? Actually, it suits their game very well, and they've got a progression system now where, like, you can tier up the more hands you're winning, and it shows you on this, like, little trophy next to you. So I'm sure you guys will see this a little bit later on. Actually, today, if you're watching, we'll be streaming a tournament, a poker tournament here, where there people can win Rifts and Goes at a final table. I think we're doing it here at 3 p.m., so that's going to be quite late for you guys. I think that's like 1 a.m. in the morning or something like that. So,
but people can join, like, say, if they've got an Oculus Go or a Rift, can they join in the tournament as well?
This is a closed build, so it's a local server, so this isn't online.
Okay.
But there's no reason why future events, and they had done events before, like they did an event in Las Vegas, where, you know, they had like a poker table set up, that's like what we've got here, was stationed around, you know, Rifts and Goes, and then everyone's able to join. And because it's cross-platform, that's kind of one of the nice things that they're kind of showing off here. But it's one of those apps that I think is, for me, originally when I first played it, and why I like this team, it was one of the first like proper social experiences where you can go in, meet people, have a chat. It's quite relaxed, and you don't have to know Texas Hold'em Poker. You just go in and say, hey guys, I'm new, can you help me understand how this all works? It's a really kind of nice social dynamic. So I like that. And the range of skills that you find in the game. So that's what I've been playing mostly.
Cool. So myself, I've been playing a lot of Augmented Empire. I've been playing it on the go now because, I've been wanting to play this game for a long, long time. Then I had the Gear VR, but I only had a Samsung Galaxy S7. So the game ran, but it was just a little bit choppy and the performance wasn't that great. And because I enjoyed the game so much, I was like, I really want to hold off and play this on the go because I know it's going to perform better. So I started playing it on the go yesterday and really sort of started getting to my teeth into the game. For those that don't know about Augmented Empire, it's a game by CoatSync, who also made Esper and also the go launch title, They Suspect Nothing. And it's basically a game where it's based in a cyberpunk sort of neo-noir city, and it's turn-based. So it's a bit sort of slow. You really have to sort of think tactically about how you're going to move, what shots to take. Then you've got a click system where you can evade shots from incoming enemies. And also, like, to get your shot right, you need to time it right as well. So there's kind of like the tactical movement element, and then this kind of timed button push element as well. But it's got like a full campaign with a story that will take you around sort of 8 hours to complete. And I'm really looking forward to going back and playing some more of that. But it performs really great on the go and looks really, really nice on the go headset. So that's kind of what I've been up to. But also checking out some Beat Saber on the side as well, of course.
Mike, what are your initial impressions of that game? Like, I mean,
I like
that kind of strategy game. You know, it's like Advance Wars or something like that.
Exactly, yeah. And that's the thing.
Strategy is quite good for...
Exactly, yeah. Like, that's the kind of thing with this game. Like, I love it a lot because, you know, I used to play XCOM when I was a lot younger. So if you're not familiar with XCOM, it was like a UFO alien type game where it's very tactical. It's from an isometric point of view, top down, where you sort of take turns between the good guys and the enemy. And then you have to move tactically around the map and take your shots and stuff like that. It's very slow paced, but very tactical. And you really have to think about things. But this game is very similar in that sense, but it's got this really cool sort of cyberpunk story that drags the game along as well. So it's a really cool game. I'd totally recommend it if you've got a go right now and you're looking for like a real hardcore sort of mainstream game to check out rather than these casual games, because there's tons of those on the go right now.
Nice.
So that is what I've been playing. So let's jump into some quick news this week. So first up, the Vive Focus may be available soon for purchase. Hot on the heels of the recently announced Oculus Go, HTC have just announced that they're making the Vive Focus dev kits available outside of China. So developers, if you've got a mobile application that you want to put on the Go, you can actually sign up right now through the HTC web portal. And if approved, you will have a Vive Focus dispatched immediately to you, regardless of where you are in the world. So this means that HTC could be gearing up towards a consumer release soon. And it would make sense now that the Go's been released that they have some competition with the Vive Focus. So HTC have a big conference coming up on the 25th of May, and it's in Shenzhen, which is where the Olympics was held. And that's where it's potentially rumored that they may announce a worldwide release. So if you're not familiar with the Vive Focus, how it sort of compares in terms of a mobile headset is that the Vive Focus has a 6 degrees of freedom headset with inside out tracking. So that's kind of the big benefit of the Vive Focus over the Go, for example, which we'll cover more in a little bit. But the Vive Focus has a 3 degrees controller similar to the Go as well. So you've got a 6 degrees of freedom headset with a 3 degrees of freedom controller. But that means that
like,
you can
I'm
move.
I'm just gonna say, remind me later to talk about it. I just tried the Focus and
yeah.
both Pico headsets, so it'd be.
Yeah, of course.
Feedback about that when we're talking VRLA later.
Yeah, definitely. It'd be nice to compare them as well to your experience with the Go. I know you've had limited sort of hands-on time with it because you've just been flying out, but definitely like hands-on first impressions would be interesting to know. But the great thing about the Vive Focus is, so you can move freely in a 3D space, right? So there was videos of people like putting them on, actually going outside and just walking for a few miles with this headset on.
You can do that, yeah.
You can't do that.
I think it's been a while ago I used it, but it's creating like a 2x2 play space for you wherever you are. So you just stand in the middle at like a free space, then you press that button and bam, you got your own little, of course you could just walk out of that area and just go to like infinity and beyond. Until you hit like a pole or a tree, but yeah.
Or a car,
or a car, or a bicycle in the Holland land, you know. But
the thing is, like, the extra freedom that you get from the Vive Focus, you have to pay the price for that. Like, it's not going to be
true.
as cheap as the Oculus Go. Like, the Oculus Go is $200. The Vive Focus is more likely to cost around $500 to $600 US dollars. But then again, you do have that sort of almost, we're almost there in terms of like fully wireless standalone headsets, a bit like what the Santa Cruz is sort of offering, and, you know, we're almost there.
And also it kind of looks ugly.
Yeah.
You said that before, crook? like an upside down crook on your head, right? Like
yeah, exactly. And it's kind of got that like, plasticky Mattel kind of looking thing. It doesn't look like a premium product, put it that way. Definitely for the price point that it is set at, which is like I say $500 to $600 probably. But the only thing that concerns me about the Vive Focus more than anything else is the library of games, because I don't know how many games support it right now. I don't know if you know that from experience, Nathie.
It's not amazing, but we're also in a development. Not everyone decides to now put it onto the store, you know. And it's still like Vive part because they use Vive part. Is something totally new, you know. The Oculus Go uses Oculus Home. It has been around for a while. It's also using a lot of Gear VR titles on there. Well, HTC has to catch up now with. But that's why it has been in like that development space for a while now, so everyone can create stuff. So most of the stuff you can play on the Focus now is Chinese stuff, you know, or Asian. But again, it's still in development.
But that's the thing a little bit now, because if you look at what Oculus has been doing in the past years, it's like making titles for the Oculus, for the Oculus Rift, for Oculus platform, Oculus this, Oculus that. They have their own studio, Oculus Studios.
Yeah.
But Vive has always been very much relying on Steam VR, which is not owned by HTC. At all, it's Valve that owns that part.
That's the thing,
the problem that they have now a little bit, and the advantage that Oculus has is that when they release the Oculus Go, they already have a platform. They already have a game development studio. They know what kind of stuff they can do, and they can develop for that. And that's a very powerful thing, because if you can both control and the hardware and the software side, that means that you can develop for that hardware before that hardware has even been released.
Yeah. And that's plus, a very Oculus Home has been around since the moment the CV1 launched. So you had to get an Oculus Home account to, well, pretty much use it. You could go to Steam as well if you wanted to, but most people did make a Oculus Home account. It was in the box when you opened it. But when you bought your Vive, there was not in the manual something like, hey, sign up for Vive part, because it wasn't around yet. So they were pretty late with that. Plus, they made a deal with Valve, of course, on the whole like hardware. So they had to first of all launch it on Steam, I'm sure. So, but you're right. That's the thing. So they have to catch up, but we'll see. I think they have a lot of stuff like going on right now. They are going to launch, but right now, that store is kind of empty. But
so, do you think Viveport will be funding games a bit like what Rowdy said with Oculus Studio? You know, they could like fund a lot of games and they help them with development, or do you don't think that will be the case?
I think they will, but I haven't really seen like something big happening yet. We had like Ready Player One that was like pretty big for them, as far as I know. But no, I haven't really seen a killer title yet, like Oculus had with Lone Echo and Arctica One and things like that. They haven't really worked together with like a big AAA developer yet. But what they have been very good on is always making like exclusive. So Rockstar Games brings out LA Noir first on their platform, and then later on it came to Oculus. So that's what they like are very good in. But I don't know. I haven't seen a big like killer title from Vive yet.
But that's also because it's tied to Steam, though, because I think that they can use that as leverage. Like, oh, you can bring it out on the Steam platform first, which is already established. While Oculus always needs to bring up, but it's a new platform. They have far less users on that platform than Steam has. So that's the advantage that they're losing now if they move away from that. If they now go to the Focus and have their own Vive port. There's not a killer title that has been released. None of those AAA titles have been released on Vive port. Or maybe they've been released, but later on.
I think this is what concerns me about any sort of mobile headset. And then Zim mentioned like the Pico, you've got the Lenovo Mirage, you've got all these other mobile headsets, the Vive Focus. And we've mentioned this so many times that content is king, right? You know, you could have the best hardware in the world, but if you've got no great titles that support it, then you're kind of just left with a headset, you know, a fancy headset that you can't really use for much. So it would be really interesting to see, especially if, like, you know, the rumor is right that the 25th of May is going to be a release for it, because that's not that long away. That's only like 20 days away. Maybe they do need some more time to get some games in development, get that like killer title that is a must have, you know, that is really like takes advantage of the 6 degrees of freedom of the headset as well. So it'll be really interesting to see what happens with the competition, because competition is great at the end of the day. You know, we've always had competition with the Rift and the Vive, and now you've got the Pimax coming out as well. And in the mobile space, you know, it's good to have that competition as well, because not only does it drive prices down, but it also promotes people developing all these games for the different applications and getting funding as well. Like you say, maybe a Viveport might fund a game, or Oculus Studio might fund a game. So it's good for developers as well, I think, in that sense. So that is the Vive Focus. Also, in some quick news this week, BoxVR is going to be free this weekend for all Oculus Rift users. If you want to try out a rhythm game this weekend, but you can't maybe afford to pick up Beat Saber, or you don't really fancy Beat Saber, I don't know why you wouldn't, because it's a fantastic game. But if you feel a little bit left out and you want to try a rhythm game, then you can jump into BoxVR for free. The great benefit that BoxVR has over Beat Saber, it has this one unique feature that is standout, and no one else has done it better, in my opinion. And that is that you're able to load up your own music into the game, and it will construct a track based on your own music selection. And the way it does that is so amazing. It's still magic in my eyes, because it syncs up almost perfectly and creates a custom track for you.
I've tried it as well with like some of the songs, but it wasn't always as great for me. I mean, I do like the game, but if I had to choose between this and Beat Saber, it's still, you know, I still prefer to have the tracks perfectly aligned to what they do. Even if they're less tracks, I just find it more fun like that.
Is it because it doesn't sync up with your Belgium like umpa tracks, like
the heavy metal hardcore?
But also a good thing about BoxVR is that it has a very, very nice progression system where it gives you all kinds of information. You can really motivate yourself to come back every day and look at that line going up and up and up. So I think that's also cool, you know, where you can really see how well you are like exercising.
And the guy in the trailer has a great mustache. Unbelievable.
Well, that's a reason in itself to go and check it out for free this weekend.
That's it. That's all you need to know.
So let's move on. I mean, Tim.
Sorry, Mike. I'm having trouble finding my way in because all you guys are frozen for me. But just doing a comment that, like, when it comes to games, I always err on the side of the one that can, you know, procedurally generate a track based on an album, because I love, like, I really was a huge fan of Audio Surf, Audio Shield, you know, any game that I could take an album, inject in, and then enjoy the thing from start to finish. Like, that is a really compelling use case for me. And actually, I find that canned games like Beats Fever, for instance, they're good, but, you know, replayability is usually quite limited on those games.
Yeah, that's true. That's why I think that if they are going to make Beat Saber even more fun by just adding like a workshop, you know, then people can just add those little blocks on the rhythm themselves and then just upload them, you know. I think they are going to work on something like that, I'm sure.
But at the same time, if you look at how many people are playing it still now, like, you know, the high scores are like, you know, everyone wants to get the highest scores. I just recently got my first perfect combo in expert mode, and I'm still enjoying it. Like, you know, I still want to keep on trying to improve and keep on getting better. And so, I don't know.
We should talk about Beat Saber now then, maybe, and move on to the Go in a little bit, because it's a nice segue to talk about Beat Saber. Because obviously Tuesday, the 1st of May, was a huge day, I think, for VR. Like, this week has been such a crazy week for VR. Like, it's been amazing. And I'm so happy to see it get such, you know, public announcements in terms of, like, the Oculus Go and also Beat Saber doing so well. It just seems like it's been a great week for the VR industry. I don't know if you guys feel the same way about that.
Yeah, definitely. It's just great.
Yeah. So Tuesday, obviously the 1st of May, Beat Saber was finally released. We were fortunate enough to get early access to it before the release. So we've been playing it for a little while, and that's why we couldn't talk about it last week when we were desperate to talk about it, because we knew how freaking cool it was.
We did.
We gave some cryptic clues that we were excited about it. And we definitely sort of said, you know, make sure the date's in your diary because it's coming out soon. But it obviously released on the 1st. It's available if you want to check it out yourself on Steam and Oculus Home. It's $20, around sort of £15. The game comes with 10 tracks that are sort of pre-made and preset by the developers, who are Hyperbolic Magnetism. What a cool name for a development studio. But they've got these 10 tracks, which are really great tracks, by the way. And if you really like the soundtrack, you can buy the soundtrack yourself from iTunes as well. But the games, you know, the beats with the rhythm are so well sort of timed that it feels just so satisfying to cut that cube. You get this kind of visceral burst of, like, sort of, you know, particles come from the actual cube when you cut it. And you get a little bit of a little haptic feedback in the controller, and then you get that awesome noise as well. And that just makes playing the game so satisfying and rewarding.
Yeah.
And, you know, everyone is loving this game right now. Everyone is playing it on Twitch. Everyone's playing it on YouTube.
You look like a badass when you... Oh, you think you look like a badass when you're doing it. But when you look at the video again, you kind of look a bit ridiculous. And those kind of games are always the best. If you look ridiculous while playing VR and you think that you're a badass, then it's the best.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. And it's got, like, difficulty levels. So you can, you know, if you're a real noob, you can go in easy and sort of, like, work your way up. A bit like the Guitar Hero games, you know, you slowly build up to get in there to expert. And then, the thing is, the jump from hard to expert is the biggest jump, I think, in my opinion. Yeah. I don't know if you felt the same way, Rowdy. Definitely. Like, hard, I was pretty good at almost straight away, because I'm sort of all right at rhythm games, playing sort of Guitar Hero back in the day. But playing it on expert is just something else. Like, there's another level. You really need to be sort of, like, in the Matrix You know, you're just seeing cubes now whenever you sleep. Yeah. You know, that's the kind of level you need to get at.
It's about so many factors. I think that you need to know the song a little better by playing it just a couple of times. So you're like, okay, this is the beat. This is what I can expect. It's really about practicing. After a while, you just master one level and then you can go to the next one, you know? It's all about feeling the beat. It's all about speed. It's all about also power, I think. Maybe the harder you hit those blocks, the better it feels.
It's not really the power. It's more like the angle at which you start and the angle at which you finish. Yeah. Yeah. And the accuracy of the how well you hit it. If you hit it on the side or in the middle or... That is what matters the most.
You're exactly right, Rowdy, because there was a lot of confusion over the scoring system, because not only can you get a perfect game, but to rank high on the leaderboards, you need to do well as well. And to do that well, like Rowdy says, the angle that you need to cut it is at 90 degrees, starting from 90 straight down, and then following through to another 20 to 30 degrees. Yeah. And then also you need to head it almost straight in the center of the cube to get like a perfect score for each cut. Yeah. And then you can rank up and then get a really decent
Which
score
is nearly impossible doing that on Expert. Expert is just like, I hope I don't make a mistake. Yeah. I hope I don't make one.
So, according to Paradise DK, Beat Saber devs hinted a level editor and defo new songs, which they hinted in a few tweets.
Yeah.
So, talking about that, what song would you guys add to Beat Saber yourselves? Like an all-time favorite song, maybe?
It'd have to be something like from David Guetta or something like that. Something really sort of like gets you pumped, has a sort of a bit of a build up to it, and then really sort of gets a bit crazy. Some sort of David Guetta song. I remember being at the V Festival last year and really going crazy to some of his tunes in the crowd. So something like that would get me hyped.
Nah, just some I don't know, like some Bob Marley. Yeah, I want that.
It's so slow that it's so hard to hit.
It's very rhythmic. It's very rhythmic. Yeah, you know,
you can do some nice things.
Yeah, but you're not like going
counter.
Like, counter.
Is there another box coming? Oh wait, there it is. Yeah, let me just wait for 5 minutes.
But it's funny because I was trying to sort of get some practice in on Expert, and there's a guy called Rue who works for the Live team. He actually has a Twitch channel that he does morning BoxVR routines every morning, and I was like, dude, like, can you give me some advice on how to play this game on Expert? And he was just like, right, just listen to the music, forget about like the cubes. He goes, there are no cubes,
the force flow through you.
There is no spoon, just forget about the blocks, just think about the music. Oh, you just swing your arms. I was like, oh mate, he's on another level, like playing on Expert is something else.
So in the chat we have someone that says, I want to do like the Rude Sandstorm. So if you guys let us know in the chat what songs you would like to have in Beat Saber. I would love to hear. But
I'll give my answer as well.
There you go.
So I'd say Killing in the Name by Rage Against the Machine.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Ooh, nice. Good track. I love the fact he's reenacted it. But also the thing about like Beat Saber, and I mentioned it in my review of the game, is that it's just so appealing to people that aren't necessarily into VR. You know, like the way it's visceral, it's got these bright lights. The game is very simple, but difficult to master. The music is really great and satisfying to play. And I was like to my wife, I was like, hey, do you want to check out this game, Beat Saber? You know, I've got it early. Do you want to check it out? And she was like, yeah, sure. You know, she's not really used to trying that many VR games. She played it and she was like, this is really good. And then like half an hour later, she's still playing it. And then like the next evening, she's like, can we play that Saber Beat game again?
And you're like, oh, cool, crud, what have I done? I'm never going to be able to play again.
Exactly. Like I've opened a can of worms there. Then
they are sweating into your headset and it starts to smell funny. That's also a thing that sucks.
Oh man. Talking about sweating, like I would get so into the game, I'd be absolutely drenched. And thankfully I've got like VR cover stuff. So like, it was just like wiped clean, but almost like I was doing one track, wiping my head down, wiping the headset down, getting back in and just playing another one. And I don't think I've sweated so much in my headset in my life, than playing Beat Saber, but you're just like, you're absolutely drenched, but you're just like, I just need one more go.
I'm going to get that perfect score now.
One more go. And then like an hour later, you're like, one more go. It's just so rewarding. But like you said, PD just said as well, the devs have been tweeting out just recently and putting out some like cryptic sort of tweets saying that they're working on new tracks. So I think because the game has been so successful, they're definitely working on new tracks that will come to the game, whether it will be additional DLC or there'll be free tracks. We don't quite know yet, but it'll be really interesting to see what happens with
this
game. They
should also bundle it with like a VR headset. That would be fun for a while, I guess. I think new people would love this stuff.
So many comments I've seen that I'm going to buy a headset just for Beat Saber. Well, that is incredible. Yeah. Like that's what we've wanted, right? Like a killer app, a VR system seller. You know, it's close enough to what we've got right now. I don't think it's going to be the one that is really going to spike sales.
But I mean, people were waiting for this one. They like how many times do you really know when a game comes out? Usually we're like Zim told us last week about like the fishing game. We're like, oh, it's out. Okay. You know, well, with this one, it's like, it's coming. We can finally talk about it, you know. So the level of excitement for certain games is always way higher than the rest. We've seen that with Skyrim, with Fallout, Lone Echo. There are a few titles, but not that much. But hopefully we will see that more, that where we can just wait for a title every week or two titles every week, you know, or every month. You know, it would be so freaking cool.
Like I mentioned about when you were talking about the jousting game by Trebuchet, you know, it's that I think what helped Beat Saber so much, like it does help the fact that it's a fantastic game anyway, but the fact that they had this like viral marketing campaign that didn't cost them anything. Like this is the amazing thing. Like the Beat Saber devs said they didn't pay any money for marketing whatsoever. And yet you had Liv who were promoting their mixed reality application and they were using Beat Saber. So both Liv and Beat Saber succeeded based on helping each other out and working together and creating this like viral marketing campaign that not only helped Beat Saber but helped Liv promote their software as well. And it was just so visceral and so vibrant and so cool to watch that you were just like, I really can't wait to check out this game. And this is what developers should maybe try to employ, is something like this, like the Trebuchet devs have done with Jousting Time, is add an interesting dynamic that makes your game really look appealing for people that just want to watch it.
Zim, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, there's a partnership here that I think is just totally missing. I'm in the camp of still haven't played Beat Saber due to a crazy week. And the thing that I think is missing is the sub-pack M2 or M2X would be, I think, probably a perfect companion for this. And for people who are asking the question, I love Beat Saber, how do I make it better? There is no better answer, I think, than that peripheral. It is a pack, backpack-shaped thing that you wear on your back, and basically for every base impact, you feel it. You can turn that thing up to really punching you in the kidneys. Like, I mean, it's really good. And the thing lasts for, you know, it'll certainly outlast you. It'll last kind of, you know, 7 hours or something like that. And if you are still playing Beat
Saber,
that's
a great idea.
I think you should call the doctor.
Yeah, that is one actually. That's one time, because I know you've mentioned the sub-pack before, and I've kind of always been a bit, I'm not that fussed. But when I think about playing Beat Saber with the sub-pack, I'm like, hell freaking yeah, that sounds awesome. Yeah, good suggestion, dude. And talking about on, Nathie, go.
Yeah, so according to PD, Josh Dapp is playing it backwards. That's interesting. Has any of you tried to play it backwards?
No.
and someone is also asking a pretty legit question is, Jamie says single Saber version for the Go.
I would love that.
I said that I think last week that it would, or 2 weeks ago, that it would be a great app for the Oculus Go if something like that would come, because I still think it's possible. Even if you don't have even if you only have 3 degrees of freedom, just one control, because they have a single Saber mode in there.
They do,
right? So I mean, it is possible to get that going in there as well. Yeah, Zim.
Just to comment on that, like, there was a whole host that I mentioned that like, these kind of beat games is the thing I've been into for years. On mobile, there used to be games like Nine Inch Nails partnered with them and a bunch of other track makers that were essentially kind of similar to the, what did you mention, Mike? Guitar Hero, where you've got, you know, beats coming at you and you were just tapping. And I think mobile music beat games for canned games is actually still a very impactful experience. And so I absolutely agree. And I would also implore any devs out there, if I can clone this model and just do your own thing with it. Like this can be successful. It doesn't have to be Beat Saber. It doesn't have to be lightsaber. It's like you know, your type of music with a beat behind it and whatever model you want, you know, start cooking those things up now.
Yeah. And talking about accessories and peripherals, you mentioned the sub pack. There was a guy on YouTube who modeled his controllers into a sort of a pipe, and then he basically had the sabers coming out both ends. So he was like a Darth Maul type. Was it Twitch? Okay, so
Rage Sack. He's a known
Rage Sack. That's an amazing Sack. Name. Yeah.
SAQ at the end, by the way.
Right.
Okay.
So he did it so he could play like Darth Maul style, and then some other people have been trying that out since, and they've been really enjoying the game that way as well. Yeah, Paradise Decay made a video of it, and Shen has been making some videos of it using the Live tool as well. Yeah. Makes it look really cool.
Yeah. Have you seen like the PD six pack?
He used the Pro Tube.
Used the Pro Tube for that. So apparently, you can do it by just putting the controllers in the opposite directions.
Yeah.
But I gotta say, that guy's video, if you haven't seen it, go watch it. He's not just like faffing with it. He's bloody good with it.
Yeah. That's next level.
He's been practicing, man. Yeah.
So you don't need to trust us, like, in our opinion. We all think the game is great, but Steam right now as well, like, if you check out the reviews on Steam, it's actually one of the highest rated games, not in VR, but just full stop on the Steam platform. Like, that's
how good
it is.
It was right after, like, PUBG, and I think there was another one there. I forgot which one.
It's actually number one right now.
It just hit yesterday. It hit number one.
Yeah, it hit number one. Yeah, it did.
It hit number one. It's beating Portal 2.
Wait. Off.
Highest rating on Steam.
Oh, you mean on Steam within a week or within a month? Not all time, right? Just this week, basically.
Yeah.
Or okay.
No,
I don't know.
We're talking all time. All time. Yeah. Like it's got
the
like
highest percentage.
Because of the percentage of reviews, like it's got 1,553 reviews right now, and it's 99% positive. So that makes the highest.
Who's that one guy? Like, I want to know, like, who is that one guy that then goes like, nah.
It was supposed to be.
He was like, I hate fun.
It was me. I said something like, I don't have a six pack yet. What is going on here? You know?
So, yeah, like I say, you know, it's got this awesome review at the moment on Steam. It's overwhelmingly positive. I've also got some stats for you as well. So on launch day, there was 1,115 concurrent users on launch day playing Beat Saber. And then every day since then, it's been really high. And today it's just over 700. To put that into perspective, like Skyrim VR, which is obviously a huge title in VR, had 3,000 at launch and has just over 581 today. So on launch, it didn't do as well as Skyrim, but it's actually taking over in terms of the daily concurrent users.
I mean, it's freaking Skyrim, you know? It's a AAA title. This is an indie little...
But this is what my point is, you know? Like, a little indie game with a little indie budget and no marketing has been able to stand toe-to-toe with a behemoth that is Bethesda and Skyrim VR and just knock it out the park. And that's what I mean. Like, if you know, even if you're an indie dev, if you've got something really great on your hands, then you could really succeed on
This shows off once again that the market is still like very open, and that it's that the market is for everyone, and not it's not getting dominated by AAA developers yet, you know?
Yeah. And it's funny because I've got some other stats as well. So like I say, 700 concurrent users on Beat Saber today. In Onward, it was only 90 today. Pavlov was 186 today. And just so I thought I'd throw it in there for fun, Kanjo VR, if you know what that is. 20 people today was enjoying the benefits of Kanjo VR.
Oh,
so there we have it. There's some stats for you, which I hope you enjoyed. So let's talk about the Oculus Go, because that is obviously big news this week as well. And it's been a crazy week, because it was announced for release on Tuesday. I got my headset yesterday. You got yours the day before, Nathie and Rowdy, the same sort of day.
Yeah.
So we've had limited hands-on time with it. Like, I've been playing it pretty much nonstop since it arrived. I can sort of show you a little bit here. We've all kind of got our headsets on show here.
It smells nice, too, by the way.
Like, before we go into the details, can I just say one thing to the audience? Guys,
sure.
Buy one.
Exactly. So if you're not familiar with the Oculus Go, it comes in two models. You've got a 32 gig model and a 64 gig model. The 32 gig model is $199 or £199 British pounds, The 64 gig model is $249 or 249 British pounds. They're shipping right now. So if you're in the US, you can go into Best Buy and they may have some in stock in a retail store, or you can order it from Oculus. But if you live in the UK or in Europe, then you're going to have to order it direct from oculus.com directly, because they're not going to be in any retail stores.
It took one day for them to deliver it though in Europe. Yeah. So it was like almost instant.
They're actually shipping them from the Netherlands, right? So, you know, if you're lucky like Nathie, you live right next to a distribution center, you're going to get one pretty quick. I actually thought they were going to be shipping from Dublin, because they've, if you look actually on the go, underneath the left wrist, the strap, it says Oculus Ireland, and has the Ireland address in Dublin. So I thought they were going to be shipping from Ireland, but they're not. They're shipping from the Netherlands. So there you have
it. Mike, that's the incorporation piece. So they Digital River out of Ireland was thinking now, but Irish incorporation is beating Brexit, because if for any anyone that was UK headquarters, a vast majority of them are moving overseas either to France or to Ireland.
Right. So the other interesting point about the headset itself is that it's actually got the Mi logo on it, which is the version of the Go which is going to be available in China that's going to have its own operating system. So it's actually going to be distributed by, I think it's called Xumi, and they're going to call it the Xumi Mi in China for the Chinese market. So that's really interesting as well. But yeah, in terms of like hands-on time with it was so simple to get up and running with. I think I got the thing out of the box. You pair it with your phone via Bluetooth and then via Wi-Fi. So once you've got a Bluetooth connection, you can put in your Wi-Fi details and then it jumps onto your Wi-Fi network and then it pairs with your phone and you can buy the applications through your phone application or through the headset itself.
Yes.
But once you set it up, you don't really need to use the phone app anymore unless you really want to.
Yeah.
But I would say like from unboxing it to being in a VR experience probably took about, 5 minutes, I would say. I know that you had a little bit of difficulty, right, Rowdy, because you're using Android, which I understand is an inferior product to Apple.
No.
Karma, like last week.
I explained the problem that I have, because I want to make sure that people who have an Android phone don't have to worry about it. The app itself, I installed the app on my phone, and then I tried it to connect it with a Bluetooth, but it couldn't find the Oculus Go headset. Well, I could clearly see in my Bluetooth file list that it was just there. So I could even see Oculus Go, but when I tried to connect with it, it said like, oh, you need to enter this code. But of course I can't enter a code on something that doesn't have a keyboard. And as long as I couldn't enter that code, I couldn't use it. So the only thing I had to do was reboot my phone so that the Oculus app could like restart again. And then I was fine.
Okay. Yeah.
So there we have also, before we move on from like the setup to the actual like first look of what we think about it. So you do need to use Facebook. You need to log in with Facebook. There is no other way, right? It's the only way you can use it. And you do need to give a lot of permission as well.
That is not true.
No, can you just create an account using an email address, can't you? Is that right, Rowdy?
I just logged in. I logged in with my Oculus account, which was not linked to my Facebook back then.
Right.
Okay. Right.
So you can do
what I did is I used my Facebook, but then it could see that my same email address got used in Oculus Home. So it linked me from Facebook to Oculus Home in the end. But what I did notice, I'm not sure if you had that, Rowdy, but when I was playing an app, it was asking me a lot of permission. Like, do you want, like when you download an app on your phone, like, do you want to use my location? Do you want to use my audio? Do you want to use my photos on my phone or something? I'm not sure if you had that, but since I linked it to my Facebook, that's what it was asking me a lot when I wanted to play something.
I even had that before I linked it to Facebook, because I don't think this has particularly something to do with Facebook, but it's more like because they're using location services to locate where, you know, they even say like when you're connecting with the Bluetooth, they need to locate the device. So for that, you need to give permission. And I think that's a little bit of like the backlash that we're getting as well from like all of the, you know, the Cambridge Analytica stuff, that everything now needs to, you know, get permission. And it is a little bit weird to be saying yes to all of those things, because it's like, Oculus, are you sure you want Oculus to let you know where you are at this moment? I'm like, I don't know. Do I want to know that? Do I want them to know that? So it's a little bit weird, but in the end, like, you know.
You do not, it's not like, because I said a lot of no to things they said, and it still works. So let's say location wise, I said like, no, I don't want that. And it still worked. And I'm sure there are apps out there that will not be able to work, but most of them I played so far just worked.
Yeah.
But I don't know. But you do need to give a little bit of permission to be able to use it.
Yeah, yeah. So before we get into the experiences that we tried, because we tried some stuff out together, right? Just want to talk about some of the specifications, because the Oculus Go actually has some upgraded optics when you compare it to the Rift. So the Oculus Rift runs a resolution of 2160 by 1200, whereas the Oculus Go runs by 2560 by 1440. So it's actually an upgraded resolution display, and it uses a single LCD panel. It's got the same field of view, though, so 110 degrees field of view, and it still uses Fresnel lenses. So you can tell that it uses Fresnel lenses by the sort of ridges in the lenses themselves. But the interesting thing about the Oculus Go is that it hasn't got any physical IPD adjustment. So unlike the Rift or the Vive, when you put it on, you have to adjust it to your IPD, which is your interpupillary distance, which is the distance between your eyes. With the Go, the sweet spot is so huge when you put the headset on that it sort of accommodates most people's IPDs. So the great thing about that is that, say you take it to a party or a family event or something like that, and you want people to try it out, you can swap between people and they can still have a really comfortable experience without having to adjust it each time. So that was pretty cool. I don't know if you guys thought that was a pretty neat feature.
I still have the feeling that the IPD is not ideally for me. For some right. reason, I still have the feeling that it's not perfect as mm-hmm. it should be. The sweet spot is large. I do notice that. Also, when I like move my eyes to like the sides, it gets quite far without getting blurry. What I had to really get used to was that fixed foveated rendering, though.
Right.
Like you have
right.
like, you know, you have a square basically that is very sharp in resolution, and then they have like blurred edges, which increase of course the field of view, and it makes it more like how would I say it? Like it increases basically the entire field of view, but you only have a very small part that sees sharp. Well, a fairly large part that sees sharp, but the edges you don't. So it feels a little bit counterintuitive for me, because I think I'm moving my eyes a lot when I look around, instead of like moving your head, which is a natural thing to do. You normally move your eyes more than you move your head. But it's much more aimed at like, you know, doing this and keeping your eyes in like a fixed point than like really moving with your eyes around. So it did take me a little while to really like get used to that kind of stuff. Yeah,
because this is the first time we've seen, like you say, it's fixed foveated rendering in this headset. So like you say, sort of layman's terms, straight ahead is crystal clear, text and everything will be sharp and vibrant, but on the edges and of your peripheral, then they'll be a bit blurry and a bit degraded. And they do this to increase performance, right? To make it more
immersed.
Yeah, exactly. And in the future, we've talked about foveated rendering a little bit on the show before, and that is like when you get eye tracking and fixed and foveated rendering at the same time, then it's full. You know, the eye tracking will know where your eye is looking, and then the foveated rendering will be based on that information. So that is the future, we think. And Oculus certainly teased some of that at F8 this week, didn't they, with some prototypes that they've been showing off.
It was insane. Yeah. Are we still having that as a topic as well today? Because I don't know.
No, we're not going to be talking about the prototypes so much, because they were just teased. Like, they even said that some of this stuff might not even ever make it into a headset. Yeah, so
I do want to say it's very interesting indeed. That piece of technology they showed there is not even like just the foveated rendering that they want to do, but the varifocal lenses, where the lenses move back and forth. That's an insane upgrade to a headset. To be doing that will increase your immersion so much, because it will actually change the way that light hits your eyes by moving your lenses further and closer. I thought that would be for like a generation 3, maybe generation 4 kind of headset, but if they want to bring that up for generation 2 already, that's a huge upgrade.
So Rowdy, like, interesting you mentioned that, because like I knew that was a thing that they talked about, but I didn't necessarily understand how that would make a difference to me.
Yeah.
But because like the way you explain it, like, you know, you've got like a kind of scientist background, you can maybe explain it in sort of some sort of layman's terms, how that would make a big difference. Like, would it make things look way more, like give more depth to a scene, for example, or make it look more real?
It will make it much more natural, because the way that normally when you have something that is far away from your eye, the way that
that hits your eye, the light from there hits your eye, or the absence of light hits your eye, that is different than when something is up close. And you can see that very well if you put a finger in front of your eye, and you look at it, you will see that this is sharp and this is all blurry. And it's also because of like the light hitting that lens differently. Your lens adjusts to that amount of light that is being hit there. And then the other thing that is also there is when you look at something that is far away, your eyes are basically parallel. If it's far away, your eyes are looking parallel. Well, if you're looking up close, your eyes will converge to a certain point. They call that vergence, right. Actually. And the other part is called accommodation. Accommodation of your eye to the closeness of the object, basically. And the vergence of your eyes, is the closer you are, the more your eyes will move together. And we can do that with virtual reality. We can simulate that vergence, but we can never simulate the accommodation part. So the part where an object that is farther away will also have a different falling of the light on your eye, we can't simulate that because our lenses are always at a fixed distance. So if we can move that distance bigger and smaller, then we can also simulate that effect of that the light hits your eyes differently.
Right, so the way I sort of like translate that in my sort of Smeagol brain is that say if I'm looking at something in the distance, like a lighthouse that's really far away, it's blurry, but when I actually focus on it, then it will become more crisp. That's kind of, so it's like your eyes focusing on an object in the distance, right? That kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah, right? That's more the vergence part. So the vergence, right, is that you focus on something. And that is clear, and all the rest around that, like I've said that before as well, like the amount of that your eye sees very sharp, it's very small, it's only a very small point. That's why foveated rendering would be, you could make a 32K display and still run it easily, just because you have to make such a small portion sharp, but all the rest can be blurry, because it's blurry anyway. You don't see that properly anyway.
We should have this as like a science time with Rowdy every week. I love this. It's really interesting.
Question for Rowdy.
Go on, dude.
So Rowdy, apparently I've heard there's some books that tell you that if you sacrifice a goat, you'll get 49 virgins when you go to heaven. Is that true?
I am going to test that though.
We've got science Rowdy, and then Zim just brings us all the way back down to earth again. So let's talk about our impressions, because we're running out of time a little bit, and I really want to touch on VRLA as well. So let's talk about first impressions, because we've all had some hands-on time with it now. Would you recommend someone go out and buy this device ultimately? Would you recommend it for someone that's got a Rift already or a PC-based headset? Because that's a big question.
Yes, so definitely. Even more.
I would be the same. So I would say that you would use it for different use cases, though, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know about you, Nathie. Do you feel the same way about it, or slightly differently?
Well, I mean, if you have the money for it, yeah.
But yeah, of course. Don't eat. Don't stop eating or something. You still need to make sure. The comparison that I like to make is like basically saying like, you know, you have a decent gaming PC. Yeah, it's really awesome, but you want something else as well, and there's something else as a Switch. You know, the Switch is not like a real hardcore gaming device, but it is still a gaming console, of course. And I see the Oculus Go like that as well. It's a different purpose. You know, it's to take with you. It's mobile. It's the games on that aren't that great at the moment. Maybe they'll be nicer in the future. I don't know. But it's an on-the-go device, media entertainment. That's the way I see it.
Yeah,
it's like a handheld VR. It's like handheld VR. That's what it is.
Yeah.
One of the things I wanted to say about that, Rowdy, is in terms of their design, I genuinely think Oculus have done an amazing job right the way through all their headsets as they've evolved. This headset, in general, right, heat dissipation through a cloth cover, the fact that it's light, the fact that it's got high resolution, there's so many features that are like, yes, yes, yes. And at that price point, it's surprising that they've been able to do it. I have one gripe, though, and I don't understand why they didn't do it. Similar to handheld devices, oftentimes if you have a controller or a something that needs to touch the screen, oftentimes it'll clip into the device. Why the controller doesn't clip in when it fits perfectly into the nose gap, why they couldn't have made that work, I don't know, because that would have saved. I'll tell you, here on site, we have four different of these things, and those controllers just keep going missing. It's like, oh, where did I put the controller? Like, why they weren't able to merge the two devices with some kind of a fancy little clip, I don't know. But I'd love to hear that answer from Oculus.
What clip? You mean, a strap or like an actual...
Like if you see like the shape of this, because I saw a picture that Zim tweeted as well.
Yeah, no,
if you can put that just like in here, which is actually already almost like that, it would actually be fairly compact, and you could like put that in there when you're done.
Yeah no, I agree.
This, right, Rowdy, if you had on the actual Go right itself, you had like a kind of a hinge that comes out that would push in like a pin into the nose place, then you wouldn't have to have anything that would touch your nose, and that could fold away, you know, when you're using it. That's my kind of thinking behind it, but for some reason they didn't decide to do that.
So interestingly, like you say, Rowdy, that, you know, if you've got your PC at home and you've got your Rift, you've got your Vive, you know, you're going to be enjoying some really great experiences. But like you say, this is a headset that is like the casual console that you can take on the go with you, right? And this is the thing, like one of the things we did yesterday, so me, Rowdy and Nathie all met up in Oculus rooms. And out of everything I've tried on the go so far, this was the most impressive thing. Like, I was absolutely blown away by it, because I would never have thought that Oculus would have the best sort of application.
It felt very smooth. It was so smooth.
So
not
natural.
Clumsy at all.
We literally just sat on a couch, and all of a sudden, I was showing you Facebook pictures of my girlfriends and myself on a holiday. Nathie was showing pictures of some videos that he shot with, I don't know what that was. And then we booted up a game. There was like this avatar that appeared out of nowhere, and we jumped from Oculus rooms straight into that game. We played a game, we finished that, we jumped back into the rooms, we went to play like some chess and some how is it called, that game Lights, and some pairs. And
yeah.
It was insane.
And it was so great, and it just worked flawlessly with very like little effort, because we play sort of fairly regularly, you know, as a team. And then when we do, it's always a real pain to get up and running, to get me in the right room, to get all the audio set up properly and everything else. With this, it was just like, put it in. Oh, Rowdy's online, invite him to a party. Oh, next thing, Rowdy's in my room. Oh, next thing, we're watching a video of a goat together on like a funny Facebook video together on a wall. And now we're playing checkers together, and Rowdy's going to beat me because I suck at checkers. And it was just so great. And I think that is a testament to what Oculus have done here, because obviously they control the hardware, but they're also controlling the software. And there's a lot to be said about a closed ecosystem. And I know that a lot of people don't like it because of it's like the Apple sort of model. But the way that they've integrated both to work so harmoniously together in this is just incredible. And like you said, Rowdy, we were sitting there together, and we could just see a list of games that we could jump into as a group. Yeah. And I could see that three of us had the game installed. So it showed on the menu that all three of us had the game installed. We can launch the game. And like you say, it was Dead and Buried that was the game that we launched. And then the avatar from Dead and Buried appeared in our Oculus room and then introduced the game to us and said, do you want to play it? And I was like, this is incredible. Like, this feels so great. The problem was that when we jumped into the game, our audio didn't work and we had some problems. We weren't all in the same game together. But that's got room for improvement for individual games. But the actual way that they launch was just next level. It was incredible.
Like the animations and how everything moves in front of you, and also the sounds as well, how like you get a ping and things. It's very satisfying.
Yeah,
that's
another really cool thing, actually. The audio on the device, because it's like built into the head strap, it's unbelievably good. Like, you don't need any headphones, you don't need anything like that. It just works.
And people around you also don't like barely hear it. So like, I was demoing it today to someone, and I could barely hear what that person was playing. So it's also really keeping it like inside the headset. So we have a few questions about to go. If you guys got any questions, just drop them now, because we have our first look ready to go. You know what I mean? So Fox wants to know, is there a light leak with the nose gap like the Rift?
Yeah,
there is. Yes. But you know, when you're in an experience, and I found this the Rift as well, is that you don't really notice it. Like, you know, I know that the gear does a better job of actually minimizing the light bleed, but the Go is
so
very comfortable.
The Vive Pro also does it better, but
exactly.
Once you're really immersed, you
barely notice it.
Okay. Yeah. And also, Ace wants to know any stutters or frame drops.
Maybe when I've been recording with it, because obviously you're yeah. putting a task on the processor there. So when I was maybe recording some of the experiences we tried, I did notice it a little bit. But when you're not recording, which most people won't be anyway, it's butter smooth.
I didn't notice any frame drops visually, but I did notice some audio issues where I was going into AllSpace, for example, where people yeah. were just you couldn't hear them that well. Like it was. It had a hard time to process that. So I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe that's like also the connection, you know? I think that is something to do with the connection and not really the, I don't know, like it's a wireless device, but.
Just quickly, whilst talking about AltSpace, because we did try and meet up in AltSpace together, was that I think it's more of an issue AltSpace side, because yeah, we were in Oculus rooms together and it worked flawlessly. As soon as we jumped into AltSpace, my mic didn't work. I had to put a pair of headphones yeah. on yeah, okay. for some reason. And it was just a bit of a mess. So hopefully the Oculus will release the SDK or whatever magic they use in Oculus yeah. rooms for other developers to implement in their games as well.
Yeah. Okay, so someone else is asking, Jarno.
Sorry, Nathie, just on the nose peak thing, I just wanted to mention yeah. that there's a benefit actually to having an open nose as opposed
okay,
to
okay, we've
the,
lost him.
The
bye.
The
no, we can
okay.
hear him.
Okay, yeah, you got him. Him. Okay.
Yeah.
He's still alive. So I'm just saying that there's a benefit to having it. Number one, if you're like me from back in the DK1, DK2 days, if you had anything touching your nose and it like would cause you to sneeze or whatever, like that can be a real pain. And the second side of this is there's actually kind of a security benefit of being able to nose peek. So if you've got a bag and you're sitting on the bus with the go on, you can actually just very quickly, quick eyes down, and just say, oh, no one's taking my bag. You know, it's, so I find it actually very helpful. And
yeah,
prefer
yeah,
that
that's
to
a good
the,
point.
To the
that's
leaves
good point.
Over the nose.
Yeah, that's a good yeah. point. Good point. Yeah. But just while we wait for some more questions, just quickly, you know, as I said, we were really impressed with Oculus Rooms. If you've got an Oculus Go now, I would suggest you go and check out Oculus Rooms. Just invite some people on your friends list and have some fun and play around with it, because you'll be really surprised how great it works. And it's actually yeah. made me more excited about the upcoming Oculus Venues and Oculus TV. Oculus Venues is where you can watch live events, concerts and sports. Together with your friends, and also Oculus TV is where you can consume like Netflix and Hulu again together with your friends. So that's really great. And another thing I just quickly want to touch on as well is something that I just tried just before the show, and that was Oculus Arcade. Now, what they've got is they've got an Oculus Arcade room, which is full of retro arcade machines from Sega, Bandai, and Namco. And you can play like Sonic the Hedgehog, Pac-Man, Gauntlet, Joust, all those kind of classic games. And every day you can play those games for 20 minutes for free. But if you want to play them infinitely, then you have to buy each individual game. But you need a controller to do that. Yeah. yeah. But 20 minutes every day you can play some retro games. That is really, really cool.
Another thing that I really noticed was that that reminded me a little bit of Ready Player One was that... When I booted it up, I was like, I mean, we already played together. I've already played with Mike before, and I booted it up. I was like, oh, let me just check if Mike is online. Oh, Mike is in his room. Like, oh, like I'm gonna ping Mike, see if he's available. I'll drop the call. Like Mike said, hey, what are you doing? Like, yeah, I'm just sitting in a room. Okay, yeah, okay, let's join together. Okay, we join together in a room. We go. What you want to do? Oh, yeah, I got this game of checkers here. Do you want to play with it? That was so insane to do that, and it made me really yeah. think of that intro from Ready Player One when he goes into the Oasis and he's looking for H. It's like, yeah. What are you doing? He's in Planet Doom, isn't that? Oh, you want to meet up?
Yeah.
It really made me think of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. The funny thing was that when we actually jumped in together, my wife was cooking dinner and I was sitting on the stairs and I was just like, I'm just going to play around with the Go quickly while you cook dinner. She was like, yeah, fine. And then next thing you know, you were there and we were in a room together. And it's funny because she was listening to like my half of the conversation that we were having. And it was just so great. Like you say, it worked flawlessly. So impressive for a mobile headset. And that's why I would recommend this for like meeting up with friends and hanging out with friends in VR.
Yeah.
Because you get that sense of presence as well. And you can just share and consume media together. And I think that's what this really does better than even the Rift does.
It's a very, very social headset, you know. And it's also really about entertainment. I don't know if gaming is really going to take it over, but being able to sit in like big screen, for example, and watch a movie together, or you know, that's going to be awesome.
Yeah. So go on.
Sorry, there was one thought I'm just thinking. Like, having tried to go out, smack me like with like a fish in the face. Is John Carmack was bloody right. This thing, it just proves the power of mobile VR and the way they've packaged it Yep. The software library, as deep as it is, I was really impressed paging through content that I'd known, but also loads of stuff that I've not played. Like you, Mike, you know, going through the different library options now, for those of us who are veterans and have kind of played it all, right? It's like all of a sudden you're in a candy shop.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's why I have to reiterate, guys, just don't hesitate. As Rowdy said, if you have to starve yourself, do it and buy this thing.
Yeah. The thing is that a lot of the naysayers about this headset, though, have been PC like headset owners, and they just don't understand why they would want something like this. But I think, a bit like VR in general, you need to try it really to understand. But, you know, yeah. Social and media consumption.
I mean, I don't know how you were, but I was totally reticent on mobile VR. Like, until I played Dispatch on a Gear VR, there probably wasn't a single VR title that I thought was compelling.
Yeah.
And this just totally changes the game. And I can say this right now. The Focus, the Pico, like all that stuff, doesn't even pale in comparison.
No.
Doesn't even come close.
The thing is, like, and that is the great thing about this headset, is that it's backed by Oculus Studios, that I still have a lot of faith that there will be some great gaming titles coming out on this platform, just because it is, at the end, Oculus Studios that is bringing us great titles on Oculus Rift, that is now also going to probably develop for this kind of platform if they want this platform to succeed. And that is an advantage that they have over the Gear VR, over Pico, over all of those other mobile headsets, because they don't have that part. And I mean, maybe it's not a gaming device at this moment, but I remembered I was talking to Mike yesterday and I was saying as well, how awesome would it be to just get simple point and click games that were very popular in, like, you know, the 90s and in the early 2000s, like The Curse of Monkey Island or whatever, like point and click games with a virtual reality concept, playing with one controller, 3 degrees of freedom is perfectly possible. You just need to do it, and you need to be original. And I have full faith in the originality of developers for doing something awesome with this kind of stuff, also in the gaming industry.
Yeah. Just another quick one, like talking about gaming, like if you don't want to use like the controller, you can actually pair a Bluetooth controller with your Oculus Go. This is a SteelSeries Stratus XL, and you can pair it via Bluetooth, and then you can play like Blaze Rush or Kin. And Kin on this headset, oh my days, you don't even know that you're wearing the Go. Like, it feels like you're playing it on the Rift. It's that good in terms of quality of the game. It's really fantastic. Yeah, but we could talk about the Go all day, I think. And I really want to cover some VRLA stuff. So we'll move on from that. Just quickly before I do move on, though, Oculus are announcing a business edition of the Go. It's going to be $300, £300. You can pre-order it now, and it'll be available in July. It's a 64 gig model with a commercial warranty and two facial interface kits. And it will have a worldwide multi-prong adapter with it as well. So if you're a developer or a business, you want to buy the Go, the business edition will be coming soon. So let's fire this over to Zim and just find out what you've been up to in VRLA. I'm really intrigued to know a little bit more before we wrap this week's show up.
Sure. So I can say that VRLA is probably the most eclectic mix that I've seen at a convention. Haven't done maybe, I don't know, 12 or so now over the last 2 years. A huge array of things from, you know, there's a corner with a bunch of spiritualists doing like a virtual experience that's like going on an acid trip. There's a dome that's got kind of stereo cinematography in a kind of half dome and then a full dome, which you could, again, if you're a prince or, off in the UAE and you want to have a flashy wedding, I suppose you'd buy that. There's platform-based VR experiences from like Eastern Europe as well, which is here. Springboard thing that you stand on, you're leaning like to be a motorbike, and the thing's shaking. So, you know, paying a fiver or a tenner for, 5-10 minutes in that, that's the kind of experience. And they sell these to various venues, malls, entertainment, venues. So there's a whole ton of things here, actually. I got to play Creed from Servius, which has been at a couple of shows as well, their new boxing title. I got to see a very interesting thing, which I've not seen it before, which was a headset sanitizer and dryer. So basically you take the Rift, it's this guy's kind of homemade product that Servius are using at the moment. It's got like three slots. You hang a Rift in it for about 60 seconds. It's got a ring of infrared lights that basically blast the headset with infrared light to kill bacteria in that.
Ah.
And neutralize it at the same time. So the headset comes out after a sweaty boxing match, and it's fine for the next person. It's brilliant. Like, I
that sounds good.
Thought of that concept, but that, yeah. They're selling in the U.S. at the moment. They're prototyping, looking for next round of funding, but that needs to go around the world. Because,
definitely,
you know,
for events. Definitely events.
Headset.
Yeah, yeah, it's horrible. It's horrible. Especially like if they're demoing Beat Saber there, you just don't want to be getting into a headset after someone. Like, no way.
Yeah. So no. Beat Saber here, there's Space Channel 5. There's a very interesting, like, they've got 10 HoloLenses and they put you into a maze. Like, you know what? Like at Halloween, there'd be like a maze that you walk through and actors would be paid to jump out at you. Well, they do that instead in AR. I haven't tried it yet. They were like, come to us, skip the queue, give it a go. But I've heard screams out of that, so that sounds that seems quite good.
So one thing I really want to know, the one thing that I really want to hear about, if you've tried it or not, is the Birdly simulator, because I saw you tweeting Kent by in this bird simulator thing. And basically, just to describe it to the audio listeners, is that it's like a table that you lie on face down and you put your hands in. Yeah, like a massage table. It's got a fan at the front of it to simulate the wind. Yep. And then you can actually tilt the table and then flap your wings like a bird. Have you tried that out yet, Zim?
I probably won't get time to. I can't back to back. But I want to. It is top of my list. If I get an opportunity tonight, I will. I'll see what the devs can do for me. But having seen Kent go through it, and Kent is a pretty, I don't want to call him stone-faced, but he's a relatively serious kind of fella, right? And for those of you who have seen the picture already, it was just glee on his face. And, and the thing is, it tilts you down and up.
Yeah.
It also has like a, almost like a, like a pneumatic press in the reverse that like pushes you up and down. So flying through a city as a bird. And the thing is, you can soar or you can just flap your wings pretty hard. And seeing person after person go through it, this is not new. This has been at shows time and time again, but they've clearly honed their craft. It's called Birdly. It's fucking weird. But as you said,
that is actually Kent By flapping as a bird. Like, I don't know. You say he's a stone-faced guy. I've seen his dancing in Beat Saber, and this guy's got some moves, man. But yeah, he's a cool guy.
I'll post it a bit later on.
If you get a chance to check it out, I'd love to know your thoughts on next week's show. So we'll wrap this show up because we've been going on for an hour and 20 minutes. Sorry that we're sort of like jam-packed, but
one thing to plug, Mike.
Sure, go for it.
Okay? Just because it's the big event, it's the reason I've flown out here.
Of course.
So again, last week I was going on about this this poker legend, Phil Hellmuth, and we were talking about this fella in relation to kind of poker VR and all that. What I didn't realize is that I'd end up probably at the table with the guy. We're going to do a stream later on, and also, so it's going to be an on-site event, but people are going to be able to watch this and actually see what like the Rift version of poker VR is like.
Yeah.
And I think it's, having just come out of a kind of half-hour play session this morning, I think it's people will want to see, because it's heavily social, it's kind of akin to what you've described, and it's a Go title. And so it's the kind of thing that, irrespective of if you know it or not, I think it's something that you should, you know, give it a go and check
so
it out.
So that show
should be live in about 3 hours or so.
So it's going to be cross-platform with Go and Rift, right?
Yes, it is. So it's basically on the table today. It's four Rifts and two Goes who are competing for the
job. Nice. And where's the best place that the people can watch this live stream for the Poker VR event?
So it'll be my show. So it'll be twitch.tv/simtalk5 is where we're casting to. And also,
nice.
If you're on site at VRLA at the moment, happen to be catching this or catching a tweet later on, you have a chance to play with the poker legend himself and compete in the tournament later. So all you gotta do is go along and sign up, and then we do the kind of random pick, and then you get a chance to compete against the legend himself.
Nice, man. That sounds like a ton of fun. I look forward to hearing more about that. So we'll wrap up the show this week. I hope you guys and girls have enjoyed it. Just to remind you, this is a weekly VR, AR, and MR talk show, live streamed every Saturday on Nathie's YouTube channel. The times have now changed, so if you want to tune into the live show, it's now 7 p.m. in Europe, 6 p.m. in the UK, and 12 a.m. in Central US. We changed the times up so more people can join us in the live stream, because I know a lot of people in the US were complaining that it's way too early, so hopefully this will accommodate you guys and girls now. If you missed the live stream, you can catch up with the whole show. I re-upload it to my own channel.
Sorry to interject, Mike. For the Central US time, I think you said 12 a.m. Isn't that 12 p.m.
It's midday.
At noon.
Yeah, 12 midday. Yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah. You can catch up, obviously, the show on my own channel, Virtual Reality Oasis, or check out the audio-only version, which is available on Google Play Music, iTunes, and on SoundCloud. So that is the end of this week's show. I know it's a jam-packed episode. We could talk about VR for hours, but we just don't want to sort of keep droning on. So I hope you guys have enjoyed this one, and we'll see you on next week's show. So until then, bye for now.